I started out wanting to be a magician, and I always broke the cardinal rule of magicianship, which was after I did a trick, I would show everybody how I did the trick. And that's supposed to ruin the illusion. But I always found it added to the illusion.
Chuck paints what he likes to call heads. He doesn't really necessarily think of his works as portraits in the 19th century attitude of what a portrait would be. In a way, it's almost about mapping the typography of a face.
From my earliest memories, I didn't recognize people or remember their faces. But I remember being in kindergarten, and by the end of the first year, I didn't know which kids were in my kindergarten class or the other one. So I knew that there was something going on, but it wasn't until much later that I really understood what I had wrong with me.
Chuck has a condition called face blindness, meaning that he does not recognize faces. That is one of the reasons that he uses photographs in his work instead of a sitter. Because if he's working with a person sitting in front of him, if that person turned their head just a little bit to the side like that, it would look to Chuck like a completely different image.
Behind me is the first portrait I painted in 1967-68, a 9-foot-high self-portrait that embodies many of the issues that I will continue for the next 30 years. I wanted to make a big, aggressive, confrontational image that was so large it could not easily be scanned as a whole, and suck the viewer right up close to it. Everything I make is from photographs, and everything for 30 years has been built incrementally. A work like the one behind me appears to be seamless, but in fact it's built out of individual units. I break down the photograph into small bite-sized pieces that allow me to concentrate on one piece until I slowly build a whole. These are my friends and my family and my fellow artists, images that matter to me and that are the subjects of my paintings.
Likeness is an automatic byproduct of what I do. I am most aware while I'm making something that I am not making a head. I'm aware of the artificiality of the situation, that it's paint on a pigment distributed across a flat surface. The fact that it ultimately stacks up to build an image which has any relation to reality is mystifying to me.
If I work from photographs, since it's already flat, I have a much better chance of remembering it. I have almost photographic memory for things that are flat. Since I don't recognize people, making portraits of people like I care about was a way to put their visage into my brain for good.
The idea of using a grid on a photograph and moving information from one square to another square, reinterpreting that information through the brush stroke, through the square of a print, allows him a sense of concentration and focus.
Well, really, all my work since 1967 has been done with a grid in one way or another. You know, it was something that was around since the dawn of time. The Egyptians scaled up things with a grid. It's a standard in the Renaissance as a way to enlarge things. But I started leaving the grid show, and that's sort of a different use of it.
In 1988, Chuck was at a speaking engagement and suddenly started to feel very ill. The last thing he really remembers is essentially crossing the street and walking into the hospital. When he woke up, he was, by all intents and purposes, a quadriplegic. As it happened, was diagnosed that his spinal artery had collapsed, something like an aneurysm in your spine. So the same kinds of tricks that he taught himself as a little boy to help him focus and learn, he brought then to the table one more time to recover to the point where he could go back to work.
It was essential. I had family, I had children, I had to figure out a way to get back to work. There just wasn't any question. The trouble was that I was paralyzed from here down, and they didn't know whether I was going to be able to move my arms, and I have no grip, I can't hold anything. But I thought, well, I'll get the paint on the canvas if I have to spit it on the canvas.
Once I get to the grid stage and I start laying them out, always one of them is more interesting than the other. I never wanted to project an image on a canvas, and the only way to get a drawing on that was in proportion to the original and accurate was to grid it off. In the early paintings, I would remove the grid as I made the painting. Around 1970, I began to do works in which the grid remained part of the piece itself. You know, it's funny because people think if you work from photographs that, first of all, everyone thinks it's cheating that you no longer have to look. But the other thing is you think once you accept a photograph, there's only one kind of picture to make from it. But all of these little subtle adjustments really make for a very different picture. Take advantage of the accidents.
Ready to start painting.
Okay, we'll put the tape on. Before I was physically disabled, I was learning disabled. I wasn't any good in school, and I wasn't an athlete. If I could have people around me, it was easier than for me to chase after other people. I did magic shows and puppet shows. For my magic act, I had a tall stovepipe hat and cape and all sorts of stuff. I think I was a pretty lousy magician, but I've always been interested in magic, and there's certainly a magic aspect to painting.
Many are called and few are chosen. Nobody ever thinks they look right. That's why I don't do commission portraits. My friends tolerate my making their image, and they grit their teeth and they get through it.